independence. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا يوافي نعمه يكافي مزيدا يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك انت كما اثنيت على نفسك فلك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد اذا رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الاولين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الاخرين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في كل وقت وحين وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد في ملء العلى ليوم الدين وصلي وسلم على سيدنا محمد حتى ترث الارض ومن عليها انت خير الوارثين نويت تعلم وتعليم وتذكر وتذكير نفع انتفاع والافاده والاستفاده والحث على تمسك بكتاب الله وبسنه رسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم ودعاء الهدى ودلاله على الخير ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وخلقه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى قال قاضي عياض رحمه الله تعالى ونفعنا به وبكم في الدارين آمين في كتابه شفاء بتعريف حقوق المصطفى القسم الأول في تعظيم العلي الأعلى لقدر هذا النبي المصطفى قولا وفعلا قال الفقيه القاضي الإمام أبو الفضل رحمه الله لا خفاء على من مارس شيئا من العلم أو خص بأدنى لمحة من فهم بتعظيم الله تعالى قدر نبينا عليه الصلاة والسلام خصوصية بفضائل ومحاسن ومناقب لا تنضبط لزمان لزمام وتنويه من عظيم قدره بما تكل عنه الألسنة والأقلام فمنها ما صرح به تعالى في كتابه ونبه به على جليل نسابه وأثنى به عليه من أخلاقه وآدابه وخص العباد على التزامه وتقلد إيجابه فكان جل جلاله هو الذي تفضل وأولى ثم طهر وزكى ثم مدح بذلك وأثنى ثم أثاب عليه جزاء الأوفى فله الفضل بدءا وعودا وله الحمد أولى وأخرى ومنها ما أبرزه للعيان من خلقه على أتم وجوه الكمال والجلال وتخصيصه بالمحاسن الجميلة والأخلاق الحميدة ومذاهب الكريمة وفضائل العديدة وتأييده بالمعجزات الباهرة والبراهين الواضحة وكرامات البينة التي شاهدها من عاصرها ورآها من أدركها وعلمها علم يقين من جاء بعده حتى انتهى علم الحقيقة ذلك إلينا وفاضت أنواره علينا صلى الله وسلم كثيرا حدثنا القاضي شهيد أبو علي الحسين بن محمد الحافظ رحمه الله قراءة مني عليه قال حدثنا أبو الحسين المبارك بن عبد الجبار وأبو الفضل أحمد بن خيرون قال حدثنا أبو يعلى البغدادي قال حدثنا أبو علي السنجي قال حدثنا محمد بن أحمد بن محبوب قال حدثنا أبو عيسى بن ثورة الحافظ قال حدثنا إسحاق بن منصور حدثنا عبد الرزاق أخبرنا معمر عن قتادة عن أنس رضي الله تعالى عنهم أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أوتي بالبراق ليلة أسري به ملجما مسرجا فاستصعب عليه فقال له جبريل أبي محمد تفعل هذا فما ركبك أحد أكرم على الله تعالى منه قال فارفض عرقا
It cannot be hidden from anyone who applies himself to the least study or who has been given the smallest gleam of understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala greatly esteems our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him peace and has endowed him with virtues, excellent qualities and fine traits too numerous to be counted. Doing any kind of justice to his immense worth would wear out both tongues and pens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's high estimation of his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam can be partly seen from what is clearly stated in his book about his exalted position. He has praised him in it for his character and his conduct. He has encouraged the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hold fast to him and obey what he imposed on them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who bestowed honour and preference on him and then praised him and rewarded him for it with the fullest reward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is overwhelmingly bountiful in the beginning and in the return, and to him belongs all praise in this world and the next. Further instances of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's high estimation of him can be seen in his presenting him before the eyes of his creatures in the most complete form of perfection and sublimity, and his distinguishing distinguishing him with beautiful qualities, praiseworthy characteristics, noble opinions and numerous virtues. He supported him with dazzling miracles, clear proofs and manifest signs of honour. These were witnessed by his contemporaries and companions, and those who came after him knew about them with certain knowledge, so that the knowledge of the reality of them has reached us and their light has overflowed on us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him peace abundantly. Anas said that the Buraq was brought, riddled and fed to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him peace on the evening of his night journey. It shied away from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so Jibreel alayhi salam said to it, "Do you do this to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? No one more honoured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than he has ever ridden you." Anas waited that upon this the Buraq broke out into a sweat.
In this first chapter, radiallahu anhu, only Imam Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala wants to affirm is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala esteems and reveres his noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi. The first section of his work, fi ta'zeem al-ali al-a'la, as it relates to the exaltation of the high, the most high, the qadri hadha nabi, the reverence of the rank of this Prophet sallallahu alayhi, the Mustafa, the one who was chosen in terms of words and likewise in terms of deeds, i.e. from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this is chapter of Imam Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, when the work is about the esteem of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his high virtue, then it's befitting that he begins with the esteem that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has towards his most noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And that's what we're going to see in the subsequent sections of this initial chapter. At the end, he brings a tradition which comes ultimately under authority of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala. In the transmission, Haddathana Abu Isa ibn Sawrat al-Hafidh, it has been related towards, this is the statement of Muhammad ibn Ahmed al-Mahbub, that has been related towards on the authority of Abu Isa, who's Ibn Sawrat al-Hafidh. That is Imam al-Tirmidhi, the great Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah ta'ala, who's possibly one of the people who's considered to be the codifier of the science of Shama'il, with a sort of great work, which is called Shama'il al-Tirmidhi, Shama'il of Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam al-Tirmidhi considered one of the great imams of the science of hadith, one of the six sort of imams who have the canonical works in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His work, that's the Sunan. But he has a very small work, really small work, 406 odd traditions, which are about elucidating the form as well as the great and immense and esteemed character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so the transmission of al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala, we see the tradition of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam Anas radiallahu anhu wardah, he's the khadim of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, somebody who kept the intimate company of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the entire Medini period. For the 10 years that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi was in Medinatul Munawwara. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enters into Medinatul Munawwara inside of this blessed month, the dominant opinion upon the 12th of Rabi al-Awwal, the entrance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam into what? Into the great city of Medina on a Monday. And the Prophet ﷺ leaves Medina to Munawwara, يعني mean that he passes away, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, likewise Rabi al-Awwal, likewise the 12th, likewise upon a Monday, likewise sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so 10 years exactly the Prophet ﷺ has inside of the blessed city. And this great individual whose name is Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda, he's brought to the Prophet ﷺ when he's only 10 years of age. So he's 10 years of age, and he's going to serve the Prophet ﷺ for an entire 10 years inside the Medina to Munawwar. He's brought by his mother, who's one of the great women of Islam, whose name is Rumaysa Sulaim bint Malhan radiallahu ta'ala anha wardaha. And she brings Anas as a young boy to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be saved by this young boy. And mashallah tabarakallah, not only Sayyidina Anas, but the entire family of bint Malhan, Sayyidina Rumaysa, is going to save the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ud'u lahu. She says to the Prophet ﷺ, make dua for him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, da'a li. Anas later relates, the Prophet ﷺ, da'a li. He made dua for me in what? What we spoke about yesterday? For barakah. He made dua for me for barakah. He made dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me barakah in my life. He made dua for me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me barakah in my children. And he made dua for me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me barakah in my wealth. Three duas. Life, wealth, children. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda lives in excess of 100 years of age, radiallahu anhu warda. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda has an excess of 300 children, radiallahu anhu warda. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, he said about his plantations. We usually have a plantation harvest once a year, that he said his plantation used to harvest twice a year, radiallahu anhu warda. To the poem, we see one of the most beautiful traditions of Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda when he's in his plantations, because he later moves to the Iraqi city of Basra. And so in Basra, one of the khuddam, the people who were saving him in his old age inside of his plantation, comes to Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda and says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has withheld rain. It's drought, there's drought. And so crops are dying or crops are not springing forth. Ud'u Allah. And they make dua to Allah Ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us rain. And so Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda, he raises his hands to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for rain. Before he puts his hands down, khalas, the clouds form and rain begins to fall. But then it goes further that Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warda thereby arises, and then he begins to inspect what? The rain. And what he finds in one riwayah, rahimahullah ta'ala, that the rain that Allah Ta'ala sent was only for his plantation. That the perimeters of his farm, that the rain never went over the perimeter of his farm. That's in one riwayah. In another riwayah, that the rain goes over the perimeters by a shibra, by that much, over the perimeters. Huh? Because he asked for rain for his plantation. Huh? And he wanted to see how perfect his dua was inside of the heavens, mashallah, tabarakallah. This is Sayyidina Anas, radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala, very, very important companion of the Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in our sort of knowledge of the personal state of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's one of the most important companions due to his proximity to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's one of the reasons why Tirmidhi himself, remember Tirmidhi in the Shama'il radiallahu anhu warda, he begins with the hadith of Sayyidina Anas. And Anas is the first of the companions mentioned inside of what? The Shama'il of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah ta'ala. In this tradition, Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhum, he said, "Anna an-nabiyya sallallahu alaihi wasallam utiya bil buraq laylat usriya bih." That the Prophet ﷺ was brought the buraq on the night that he undertook that great journey from Mecca to Jerusalem. Isra wal Mi'raj. Okay, upon that night that the buraq was brought up to the Rasul ﷺ. In other traditions in Bukhari, Muslim and others, that we know that was by the great archangel Gabriel ﷺ, as well as the great archangel Michael, Mikael ﷺ. Those two great archangels. That only brings the buraq. And the buraq is this great beast of the prophets themselves. A beast that like Sa'id ibn Musayyib rahimahullah ta'ala and Abu Salah ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Auf from the Tabi'een, Khiyar al-Tabi'een, that they said this is the beast of the prophets themselves. That all of the prophets rode him. In particular, they mentioned Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. That's how Ibrahim comes to and fro between Jerusalem and Mecca to al-Mukarramah upon the buraq. But now the buraq is for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so they bring it forth for the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muljaman musraja, and the buraq is like a mule type beast, but it has the face of a human being. The buraq, it has the face of a human being, so it's a different type of beast. Buraq in the Arabic language, balk, lightning. It travels at the speed of light. The Prophet ﷺ, he says, when it lifts up its hooves and it places them down ala muntahal basar, and upon the horizon. The Prophet ﷺ said, when it puts its hooves down, yu'abbir an here. The expression is to try to convey or to express the speed, the radical speed at which the buraq travels. But it comes muljaman musraja. Muljam, at iljam, bridle. Musraj, saddle. So it comes bridle and saddle. What is that telling you? Discipline.
And the beast is disciplined. Oh, it's been disciplined by the prophets, and the prophets are just disciplining the buraq for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They're readying the buraq for the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he's arriving. فَاسْتَطَعْبَ عَلَيْهِ فَاسْتَصَبَ عَلَيْهِ. Although the buraq is what? Is disciplined when the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes to what? Goes to ride the buraq, goes to mount the buraq. The buraq is being like a bit difficult. فَاسْتَصَبَ عَلَيْهِ. فَقَالْ لَهُ جِبْرِيَ. What does Gabriel alayhi salam say? أَبِي مُحَمَّدٍ تَفْعَلُ هَذَا. Are you doing that with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Are you doing that with him? Gabriel says, فَمَا رَكِبَ أَحَدٌ أَكْرَمُ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى مِنْهُ. Because there is nobody who has ever ridden you that is more noble in the sight of Allah Ta'ala than this man. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. قَالَ أَنَسْ. What did Anas say? فَارْفَضَّ عَرَقًا. فَرْفَضَّ عَرَقَ means now the buraq begins to sweat. Huh? Realization on behalf of the buraq inside of this riwayah about who is about to what? About to mount him, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The shahid, the proof Imam Qadi Iyad, rahimahullah ta'ala, wants to bring by bringing this riwayah, radhiallahu anhu warda in Tirmidhi, is فَمَا رَكِبَكَ أَحَدٌ أَكْرَمُ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى مِنْهُ. That there is nobody who's ever ridden you who is more noble, more honorable in the sight of Allah Ta'ala than him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the part he wants. Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala. Remember, those who rid the buraq before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the prophets themselves, was the prophets themselves. الباب الأول في ثناء الله تعالى عليه وإظهاره عظيم قدره لديه. اعلم أن في كتاب الله العزيز آيات كثيرة مفصحة بجميل ذكر المصطفى وعد محاسنه وتعظيم أمره وتنبيه قدره. اعتمدنا منها على ما ظهر معناه وبان فحوى وجمعنا ذلك في عشرة فصول. بسم الله.
Chapter 1. Allah's praise for him and his great esteem for him. This chapter is an exposition of some of the clearest ayahs in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and speak well of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him peace. Enumerate his good qualities and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's esteem of him and praise him. Section 1. Concerning praise of him and his numerous excellent qualities. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, a messenger has come to you from among
yourselves. So this is the first chapter, al-fasl al-awwal. Okay, I'lam anna fi kitabillahi al-aziz ayatin kathira mufsahatan bi jameel al-dhikr al-mustafa. He said, no, first and foremost, that in the book of Allah Ta'ala, al-aziz, the mighty book, the Quran, there are a great numerous amount of clear, unequivocal verses that elucidate the beautiful mentioning of the Prophet al-Mustafa. And likewise, such verses will enumerate his beautiful qualities and extol his affair and clarify his great rank. Okay? We have only relied upon those meanings which are evidently clear inside of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He makes mention of رَضَى عَنْهُ وَرْضَى الْفَصْلِ الْأَوَّلِ, the first chapter. فَمَا جَاءَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ مَجِيَ الْمَدْحِ وَثَنَاءِ وَتَعْدَادِ الْمَحَاسِنِ كَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَءُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. قَالَ سَمَرْقَنْدِي رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَقَالَ بَعْضٌ مِّنْ أَنفَسِكُمْ بِفَتْحِ الْفَاءِ وَقِرَاءَةِ الْجُمْهُورِ بِالضَّمِّ. قال القاضي إمام أبو فضل رحمه الله تعالى, أعلم الله تعالى المؤمنين والعرب وأهل المكة وجميع الناس على الاختلاف المفسرين من المواجه بهذا الخطاب أنه بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يعرفونه ويتحققون مكانه ويعلمون صدقه وأمانته فلا يتهمونه بالكذب وترك النصيحة لهم لكونه منهم وأنه لم يكن في العرب قبيلة إلا ولها على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولادة أو قرابة. وهو عند ابن عباس وغيره معنى قوله تعالى إلا المودة في القربى سورة الشورى, وكونه من أشرفهم وأرفعهم وأفضلهم على قراءة الفتح. وهذه نهاية المدح. ثم وصفه بعد بأوصاف حميدة وأثنى عليه بمحامد كثيرة من حرصه على هدايتهم ورشدهم وإسلامهم وشدة ما يعنتهم ويدر بهم في دنياهم وأخراهم وعزتهم عليه ورأفتهم ورحمته بمؤمنين. قال بعد ما أعطاهم اسمين من أسمائه رؤوف الرحيم ومثله في الآية الأخرى قوله تعالى بسم الله.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs the believers or the Arabs or the people of Makkah or all people according to different commentaries on the meaning of these words that he has sent to them from among themselves a messenger whom they know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, a messenger has come to you from among yourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs the believers, or the Arabs, or the people of Makkah, or all people, according to different commentaries, or the meaning of these
verses. Here brings the entire verse, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولُ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. There indeed has come a messenger from amongst you, unto you, عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُمْ. Yani whatever afflicts you is difficult for him to bear. حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. He is eager with regards to you, are you concerned? With regards to your affair, بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He's concerned about the believers and he is compassionate and merciful, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the verse, end of Surah At-Tawbah.
He has sent to them from among themselves a messenger whom they know, whose position they are sure of, and whose truthfulness and trustworthiness they cannot but recognize. Therefore, since he is one of them, they should not suspect him of lying or of not giving them good counsel. There is no Arab tribe without descent from or kinship with the Messenger of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him peace. This, according to Ibn Abbas and others, is the meaning of his words, accept love for king. He is from the noblest, highest, and most excellent of them. How much further in the ayah can praise go?
So in this first verse, he brings, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. So he wants to look, radiallahu anhu, Qadi Iyad, at the word أَنفُسِكُمْ. That indeed, yani a messenger has come unto you, min anfusikum. That's the first reading of the Quran, which is the reading of the Quran. Yani min anfusikum, from amongst yourselves. That's almost like min anfusikum. He says, Qala Samarkandi, Imam Samarkandi says, wa qara'a ba'duhum. Some of them recited that verse, min anfasikum. As we mentioned yesterday, not min anfusikum, min anfasikum. Anfus, selves. The nafs is the self. Okay, the word nafs in the Arabic language, it can be pluralized upon nufus, or it can be pluralized upon anfus. It has two plurals in the Arabic language. Nufus or anfus. So here in the Quran, anfus. From yourselves. Okay, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the word nafs, which is the most precious reality that the human being has, and that's the life spirit of man, in the Arabic language, it also alludes to, in the language of the Arabs, to that which is what? Precious. Nafs, nafas. Nafs is self. Nafas is your breath. And then something that is nafis is something that is extremely precious or extremely valuable, because the self and the breath of man, which is the indication of what? Of the presence of the self, is extremely precious. It is the life force, the life spirit of the human being in and of himself. So when you say anfus, it's the plural of selves, souls. When you say anfas, it means the most precious or the most valuable. Okay, so not just that slight change from anfus to anfas. That change brings about a nuanced meaning from selves to most precious. Everyone understand? And so the reading of the Quran is min anfusikum, from yourselves. Okay, but he brings, like Samarkandi rahimahullah ta'ala said, that some of them read it min anfasikum. And in particular, who read it that way? Sayyidina Aisha read it that way, Sayyidina Fatima Zahra alayhum as-salam. That's how they read it, min anfasikum, not min anfusikum, in the qira'at of Sayyidina Aisha and Sayyidina Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Wa qira'atu jumhur bid-dam. But the majority read it min anfusikum, from yourselves. Not that he is, a messenger has come unto you from the most precious, the most valuable from amongst you, okay? Meaning an allusion to who the forefathers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were. قال القاضي الإمام أبو الفضل رحمه الله أعلم الله تعالى المؤمنين. Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to? Allah ta'ala said, لَقَدَ جَاءَكُمْ. Who is the كُمْ? Who is he speaking to? رضي الله عنه قاضي عياد said, Allah ta'ala is informing the believers. Allah is speaking to the believers. Position number one. Or Allah Ta'ala is speaking to the Arabs. Position number two. Or Allah Ta'ala is speaking to Ahlul Mecca. He's addressing the people of Mecca. Position number three. Or Allah Ta'ala is speaking to the entire humanity. Position number four. He brings four positions, radiallahu anhu warda, al-ikhtilaf al-mufassirin. That in accordance with the differences of opinion held by the people of the tafsir of this verse, radiallahu anhu warda, man al-muwajah bihad al-khitab, as it relates to who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually addressing. أَنَّهُ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا, that Allah Ta'ala sent amongst them the believers, or the Arabs, or the people of Mecca, all the entire humanity, that He sent amongst them a messenger, مِنْ أَنْفُسِهِمْ, who is from their own stock. He's flesh and blood, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. يَعْرِفُونَهُ, they know him, they recognize the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like Allah Ta'ala said, يَعْرِفُونَهُ كَمَا يَعْرِفُونَ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ, they know him in the same way they know their own children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَتَحَقَّقُونَ مَكَانَ وَيَعْلَمُونَ صِدْقَهُ وَأَمَانَتَهُ, and they are certain and they know his truthfulness and his trustworthiness. The Prophet ﷺ in Jahiliyyah, before revelation was given to the Rasul ﷺ, he was the Sadiq, he was the Masduq, the truthful one, the one in whose truth was vested. He was called Al-Amin, like you see at 35 years of age, when the black stone is being replaced and he enters into the Kaaba, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Radina bil-Amin, Radina bil-Amin. That's how they begin to call out the Rasul. They call him the Amin. Or likewise, he's also the Ma'moon. Again, Amin is the one of trust. The Ma'moon, likewise, the one of trust. Saqaq biha al-Ma'moonu ka'san rawiyatan. In Ka'b ibn Zuhayr's famous poem, he called the Prophet as a Ma'moon, although he was an enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's truthfulness as well as his trustworthiness was well known. فَلَا يَتَّهِمُونَهُ بِالْكَذِبِ, nobody ever accused the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of lying, of having ever lied. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why, you know, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the Siddiq, would say, يعني, if we have no accusation against him about lies upon earth, we're going to accuse him of lies inside of the heavens, as it relates to the heavenly path, Abu Bakr would say. وَتَرْكُ النَّصِيحَ لَهُمْ لِكَوْنِهِ مِنْهُمْ وَأَنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي الْعَرَبْ قَبِيلَ إِلَّا وَلَهَا عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَلَادَ أَوْ قَرَابَ. And likewise, he also mentioned something which is more tribal in nature, that there's not a single tribe from amongst the Arabs save that in some way they connected to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. That they connected to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani in some type of yani blood relationship. And as a rule, those of us who study the nasab of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's mawdi', through his mawdi'. His mawdi' is the lineage through his mothers. And through the lineage of his mother sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it branches out such that it connects to all of the varying tribes of the Arabs. And all here Imam Qadi Iyad wants to prove, radiallahu anhu warda, is that the Arabs know him. They connect to him. He is from them, literally in blood. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. طيب. وهو عند ابن عباس وغيره غيره معنى قوله تعالى إلا المودة في القربى. إلا المودة في القربى. The only thing that we ask of you is love for my family, في القربى. Love for those who have blood ties with me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn Abbas's opinion, radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala. Tayyib,
bismillah. Allah subhanahu wa
ta'ala. Ar-Rahim, Allah ta'ala is Ar-Rahim. Ya Allah ta'ala called the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his book, Rahim. Wa bil mu'mineena ra'uf Rahim. And again, this is again the reverence, the esteem held by the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala towards his beloved, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa mithlo.
The same point is made in another ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was kind to the believers when He sent among them a messenger from among themselves. Another ayah says, He is the one who sends a messenger from you among the unlettered people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, as we sent among you a messenger from you. It is related that Ali radiallahu anhu said,
so here, so wa mithluhu radiallahu ta'ala anhu, في الآيات الأخرى قوله تعالى لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. وفي الآية الأخرى هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. وقوله تعالى كما أرسلنا فيكم رسولا منكم يتلو عليكم آياتنا ويزكيكم ويعلمكم الكتاب والحكمة ويعلمكم ما لم تكونوا تعلمون. All he brings in these three verses, radiallahu anhu, that the other verses in the Quran that are affirming that the Prophet first and foremost is a messenger, and that he's minhum, that he's from them. As we said, the positions from them, from the believers, no doubt whatsoever, that he's from the Arabs, no doubt, that's the part Imam Qadi Iyad is focusing upon, that he's from the people of Mecca, likewise, also that he's from the stock of humanity, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Verses Allah Ta'ala confirms that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is from the stock of man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his different interpretations. وَرُوِيَ عَنْ عَلِيٍّ ابن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنه صلوات الله تعالى عليه في قوله تعالى من أنفسكم قال نسبا وصهرا وحسبا ليس في آبائي من لدن آدم سفاح كلنا نكاح قال ابن الكلبي كتبت للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم 500 أم فما وجدت فيهن سفاحا ولا شيئا مما كان عليه الجاهلية وعلي بن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنه في قوله تعالى وتقلبك في الساجدين قال من نبي إلى نبي حتى أخرجك نبيا وقال جعفر بن محمد علم الله عجز خلقه عن طاعته فعرفهم ذلك لكي يعلموا أنهم لا ينالون صفوة من خدمته فقام بينهم وبينه مخلوقا من جنسهم في السورة والبسه من نعته الرأفة والرحمة واخرجه إلى الخلق سفيرا صادقا وجعل طاعته طاعته وموافقته موافقته قال تعالى من يطيع الرسول فقد طاع الله وقال تعالى وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين.
It is related as Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from among yourselves mean by lineage, relationship by marriage and descent. There was no fornicator among his forefathers from the time of Adam alayhi salam.
That's the position of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. That qala nasaban, min anfusikum, that the relationship here is nasab. Nasab means the lineage through the fathers, okay? Through the line of the fathers. Sahra is your lineage, your connection through marriage, okay? I.e. to the blood relatives of your wife or the blood relatives of your husband, Sahra. And then hasad likewise also relates to the great sort of esteem that was held, or the reputation that was held by the forefathers of any particular person. In this case, it's the Prophet ﷺ. لَيْسَ فِي أَبَائِي مِنْ لَدُنْ آدَمْ سِفَاحْ كُلُّنَا نِكَاحْ. The Prophet ﷺ says that in my forefathers, from the time of Adam, there is no illicit relationships whatsoever in any of my forefathers. كُلُّنَا نِكَاحْ. All of our forefathers, my forefathers, were through marriage. They came forth through marriage. The Prophet ﷺ says, all the way to Sayyidina Adam, alayhi salam.
All of them were properly married. Ibn al-Kalbi said, I wrote down 500 female ancestors of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, may Allah Ta'ala bless him and grant him peace, and I did not find any fornication among them, nor any of the evils which were prevalent in the Jahiliyyah period.
I mean, but look what was preserved about the four mothers of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn al-Kalbi rahimahullah ta'ala. Katabtu lil-Nabi 500 that I studied 500 of the four mothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 500 of the four mothers. فَمَا وَجَدْتُ فِيهِنَّ سِفَاحًا وَلَا شَيْئًا. I never found no illicit relationships as it related to the four mothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I never found anything from what we would see prevalent in the age of Jahiliyyah, dominant inside of their society, but they were what? They were very different to the dominant way or the dominant women inside the societies in which they lived. Four mothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But of the most beautiful things in that regard is, subhanAllah, from the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 500 four mothers prior to him, and why was knowledge of those great women preserved? I mean, that's ajib, eh? That Imam Rallahu Anhu Warda can unearth the biographies of 500 of the mothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, four mothers, and find that they are women at the highest level of istiqama, highest level of rectitude. Allah Ta'ala preserves for the reason. فَأَمَّا مَا يَنْفَعُ النَّاسِ فَيَمْكُثْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, as Allah Ta'ala says. As for that which benefits people, it shall remain upon the face of the earth. It shall be preserved.
Ibn Abbas said that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you turn about among those who prostrate, mean from prophet to prophet until I brought you out as a prophet.
In the purity of his lineage, wa taqallubuka fi sajidin. Wa taqallubuka. And taqallub is movement. Like Allah Ta'ala said, لا يغرنك تقلب الذين كفروا في البلاد. Do not be deceived by the movement of those who disbelieve upon the face of the earth. Don't be deceived by that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. So taqallub is about movement. And Allah ta'ala says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa taqallubuka, your movement, your sojourning, fi sajideen, in those people who fall prostrate. And so Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas says the sajideen here, min nabiyyin ila nabiyyin ila waliyyin ila waliyyin ila waliyyin ilayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From prophet to prophet to prophet to prophet till it stops at Ismail. Then from Wali to Wali to Wali to Wali to Wali to Wali until it ends at his father Abdullah alayhi salam, and then the Prophet comes forth thereafter. Nah? That's the qallubaka fi sajidin. All of the forefathers of the Prophet sallam, were muwahidun. They were people who prostrated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the radical belief of the oneness of Allah ta'ala. Okay? That's what we mean by rectitude. Okay? It's not just physical rectitude, which can relate to sort of upright or illicit relationships with the physical form of man. But it's also about what the rectitude of the soul, of the spirit in and of itself, and the stamp of that is Tawheed, the belief, the radical belief in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyip. وقال جعفر بن محمد علم الله عز خافي عن طاعته فعرفهم ذلك لكي يعلم أنهم لا ينالون الصفوة من خدمته. طيب, this statement of saying جعفر بن محمد, جعفر بن محمد, the great Imam جعفر الصادق رحمه الله تعالى, and جعفر الصادق, يعني Imam of the one of the people of the people of the أتبع تابعين, people of the أتبع تابعين, saying جعفر الصادق is جعفر بن محمد. That Muhammad is Muhammad al-Baqir. Muhammad al-Baqir, the son of Zain al-Abidin, Zain al-Abidin, the son of Sayyidina Hussein, Sayyidina Hussein, the son of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, Sayyidina Fatima Zahra al-Batul. Imam of Medina al-Munawwara, Sayyidina Ja'far al-Sadiq, known as Ja'far ibn Muhammad, rahimahullah ta'ala. He died in the year 147, mashallah, 3 years before the birth of the great Imam al-Shafi'i, Ja'far ibn Muhammad. Teacher of Imam Malik ibn Anas, radiyallahu anhu warta, Imam of Ahl al-Bayt.
Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that his creatures would not be capable of pure obedience to him. So he told them this in order that they would realize that they would never be able to achieve absolute purity in serving him. Between himself and them, he placed one of their own species, clothing him in his own attributes of compassion and mercy. He brought him out as a truthful ambassador to creation and made it such that when someone obeys him, they are obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when someone agrees with him, they are agreeing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever obeys the messenger has obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we did not send you except as a mercy to all the worlds. Abu Bakr Muhammad ibn Tahir said,
Ish'ar here, what alludes to Imam Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, is the reality of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his true reality. And in the world of spirit, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew that had the Prophet ﷺ manifested in his true reality, we would be incapable of obeying the Prophet ﷺ. فَبِرَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِمْتَ لَهُمْ. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now clothes the Prophet ﷺ in mercy. The first sign of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it relates to the Prophet ﷺ, Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala says, is the Prophet ﷺ, مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. That he comes in the form of us. We have two eyes, he has two eyes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have a face, he has a face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Flesh, flesh. Blood, blood. So now we can relate to the Messenger of God, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that relationship makes things easier for us. What does it make easier for us? Obedience to the Messenger of God, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because ultimately, as the verse is going to say, يعني من يطع الله فقد ومن يطع الرسول فقد أطاع الله. That whoever obeys the messenger has obeyed God. Meaning disobedience to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم is disobedience tantamount to disobedience to God. But what about if we were unable to obey him by virtue of his reality? So the first sign of mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the spirit of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to connect to a form that we recognize, that we can relate to, because the nature of form means it's going to govern what a person can do. Yani angels don't behave like man, save when they come in the form of man. Then the form of man begins to govern what angels do inside of the lower realm. وَكَذَلِكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Likewise the Messenger of God. when that great spirit manifests inside of the womb of Zuhra and thereby manifests inside of the lower realm, the form of the Prophet ﷺ is going to govern what the spirit, quote unquote, can manifest in the dunya. And that is governed by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to move inside of the sphere of obedience to God subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without that, la yumkin, impossible. He says, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. That's why he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qama baynahum wa baynahu makhluqan min jinsihim fissura. Look at this, fissura. That Allah has established the Prophet in our midst, yani, as one who is from our stock, albeit from the outward perspective. Outwardly, this tashabbuh, that there is a similarity between us and the Prophet, outwardly, and in the most superficial sense. But that superficial sense is what facilitates obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَالْبَسَهُ مِنْ نَعْتِهِ رَفَّ وَرَحْمَةً. And Allah ta'ala has donned the Prophet وسلم, in his attributes of compassion and mercy. Once again, for facilitation of obedience. وَخْرَجُوا إِلَى الْخَلْقِ سَفِيرًا صَادِقًا. And thereby Allah ta'ala dispatches him to creation as an ambassador who is true in nature. وَجَعَلَ طَاعَتَهُ طَاعَتَهُ. And Allah ta'ala has made obedience to the Prophet ﷺ obedience to him. Okay, how is that? وَمُوَافَقَتَهُ مُوَافَقَتَهُ. And you're concurring with the Prophet ﷺ, a concurrence with God. Did not Allah ta'ala say, وَمَا يُتِعَ الرَّسُولِ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whoever obeys the messenger has obeyed God. Did not Allah ta'ala say, we have not sent you save as a mercy to the world.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we did not send you except as a mercy to all the worlds. Abu Bakr Muhammad ibn Tahir said in explanation of this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala imbued Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with mercy so that his very being was mercy. Wow. And all his qualities and attributes were mercy to all creatures. Whoever is touched by any aspect of his mercy is saved in both worlds from every hateful thing and obtains everything he loves. Do you not see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we did not send you except as a mercy to all the worlds. His life was mercy and his death was mercy.
Hakadha the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Ja'far ibn Abu Bakr ibn Tahir al-A'in zaykin Allah ta'ala Muhammad ibn Zinat al-Rahma. That Allah ta'ala has adorned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the adornment of mercy. And it is not coincidental that you look at the traditions that relate to what Allah ta'ala imprints in the universe first and foremost. It's one of two things, mercy or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's all tradition that the mercy or the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In one tradition, we'll find that Allah ta'ala says that in Sahih Bukhari that the first thing Allah ta'ala inscripted on the universe was Rahmati, my mercy, sabaqat ghadabi, outstrips my wrath. Then we find another tradition that the first thing Allah ta'ala inscripts upon the universe is La ilaha illallah Muhammad. Muhammad Rasulullah. Muhammad is the messenger of God. And then it's brought together in the verse quoted by Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Same as a rahmat, the alameen, is to the entire creation, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. This is unfathomable. Unfathomable that. And the Prophet is a mercy to the entire creation. And where do you begin to try to understand that verse? And how do you begin to try to understand the Prophet 1500 years ago is a mercy to those in the generation of Adam, or those in the generation of Nuh, or those in the generation of Ibrahim? How do you begin to try to fathom that? How do you begin to try to fathom that the Prophet 1500 years ago is a mercy to those inside of our day and age? A mercy to those inside of our fathers and our grandfathers and our great grandfathers' day and age. How do you begin to fathom that? How do you begin to fathom the Prophet being a mercy sent to those who exist upon Mars, or those who exist upon Pluto, or those who exist upon Jupiter or Saturn? How do you begin to fathom that? How do you begin to fathom the Prophet being a mercy to the animal kingdom, to the plant kingdom, to the inanimate kingdom, to the fish, to the birds? How do you fathom it? How do you fathom the Prophet being a mercy to the seen realm in its entirety, the observable universe? Okay, how do you begin to fathom that? 13.7 billion light years from the center. That's what they tell us now. 13.7 billion light years to the boundary. From the center, the actual radius of the universe of Allah Ta'ala in the observable sense. And he's a mercy to all of that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do you begin to fathom that? What is the observable universe as it relates to the world, to the non-observable universe? What do they tell us? 2%? That's it? 2%? That's science? So what about the 98% on their estimation of the unseen realm? And he's a mercy to that. Rasul Sa'ad, mercy to Gabriel, mercy to Mikael, mercy to Azrael, mercy to Israfil. How do you fathom it? And Deen wants us to at least attempt things. SubhanAllah. Man huwa sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And then when you begin to fathom that Allah made him that. What's Allah's estimation of him then? Huh? Allah Ta'ala, what's his estimation of the Messenger of God sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That one being a mercy or the intermediary of his mercy to his entire creation from the beginning to the end. And the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows no end. Just like the mercy of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows no end. هكذا زين الله تعالى محمدا بزينة الرحمة. That's what the Rasul said, أنا رحمة المهدى. I am the gift of mercy. I am the gift of mercy. That's what he calls himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the hadith of Sayyidina Salama with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, our dua, if we make dua against you, it's dua for you. How do you fathom that? You know, someone yadu, they make dua against you. And all, the only way Allah Ta'ala interpreted the dua against of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is dua for. I mean, it's like there is no negative aspect from him. And if there was something negative, it's only seen as positive from the Divine Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Hakadha al-Messenger of Allah, فَكَانَ كَوْنُهُ رَحْمَةً. His being is mercy. وَجِمِيعَ شَمَائِلِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ رَحْمَةً عَلَى الْخَلْقِ. All of his character traits and his attributes are all mercy upon creation. فَمَنَ صَابَهُ شَيْءٌ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ فَهُوَ النَّاجِ فِي الدَّارَيْنِ مِنْ كُلِّ مَكْرُوهٍ. The one who gets a portion, that's all Qadi Iyad said, a portion of the mercy of the Prophet ﷺ, then he is saved in both worlds from all types of evil, all types of harm. وَالْوَاصِلْ فِيهِمَا إِلَى كُلِّ مَحْبُوبٍ. And that will bring them unto everything that is beloved. Allah Ta'ala and Allah Ta'ala yaqul, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Don't we see that Allah Ta'ala says, we've only sent you as a mercy to the world? فَكَانَتْ حَيَاتُهُ رَحْمَةً. His life was rahmah, mercy. وَمَمَاتُهُ رَحْمَةً. And his death is mercy. صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.
As the Prophet himself said, my life is a blessing for you and my death is a blessing for you.
كلام الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم كما قال عليه السلام حياتي خير لكم وموتي خير لكم وكما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام إذا أراد الله رحمة بأمة قبض نبيها قبلها فجعله لها فراغا وسلفا وقال سمرقندي رحمه الله رحمة للعالمين يعني للإنس والجن وقيل لجميع الخلق للمؤمن رحمة بالهداية ورحمة للمنافق بالأمان من القتل ورحمة للكافر بتخيير العذاب قال ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما هو رحمة للمؤمنين والكافرين وللكافرين إذ عوفوا مما أصاب غيرهم من الأمم المكذبة وحكي أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لجبريل عليه السلام هل أصابك من هذه الرحمة شيء؟ قال نعم كنت أخشى العاقبة فأمنت لثناء الله عز وجل علي بقوله ذي قوة عند ذي العرش المكين مطاع ثم أمين.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires mercy for the community, he takes its prophet to him before them, and he makes him one who goes ahead to prepare the way for them. As Samarkandi explains that the words "a mercy to all the worlds" mean for both the jinn and mankind. It is also said that it means for all creation. He is a mercy to the believers by guiding them, a mercy to the hypocrites by granting them security from being killed, a mercy to the unbelievers by deferring their punishment. Ibn Abbas
in Hayati khayrun lakum, that my life is good for you and my death is good for you. Hadith azim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wasallam, hadith al-Bazar. Sunnah.
Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, he is a mercy to the believers and also to the unbelievers, since they are saved from what befell the other communities who cried lies. It is related that the Prophet said to Jibreel alayhi salam, has any of this mercy touched you? He replied, yes, I used to have fear about what would happen to me, but now I feel safe because of the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised me when he said, securely placed with the Lord of the throne, obeyed there, trustworthy.
ذي قوة عند ذي العرش المكين. That's Gabriel, ذي قوة. Okay, Gabriel is the one of extreme power. Allah Ta'ala calls him ذي قوة, the possessor of power. Allah Ta'ala calls him يعني شديد القوة, the one of extreme powers. Gabriel, mentioned over 30 times, mashallah ta'ala, in praise inside of the Quran. But in this verse, عند ذي العرش المكين. Okay, and with the one, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the possessor of the famed throne. Allah Ta'ala esteem and Gabriel. Mutar, that's the point. Why is Gabriel being praised? Because he's mutar, and he's in a state of obedience. Thamma amin, for that trustworthy one, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Gabriel, praised by Allah Ta'ala, and thereby secured. Like, I used to be in fear of God, until Allah Ta'ala praised me in the Quran, because of my relationship to you. Alayhi salam, Gabriel. MashaAllah, huh? That gives a lot of us hope, isn't it? It gives us hope. We're his ummah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so we have a relationship with the Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All that needs to happen is that we have to make that relationship good. So Allah Ta'ala, Yawm al-Qiyamah, says about us, Anta muta'a. Yawm muta'a. Thamma ameen. That ameen, that one there. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
It is related that Ja'far as-Sadiq, said that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, peace be upon you, from the companions of the right, mean because of you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The cause of their peace is the high honor bestowed upon the Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Fasalamun laka min ashab al-yamin. Sayyidina Ja'far Sadiq says, Salamun bika, by virtue of you, ashab al-yamin, the people of paradise, have salam. They will have peace inside of paradise. And the people of the right hand have peace in paradise, bika, salamun bika. He said, the lamb here understood as a ba. You see how often of the people, if you look at Ridwan, and Ridwan opened in Hadith in Sahih Muslim, Ridwan, the gatekeeper of paradise, what's his first word to the Prophet ﷺ at paradise? Sahih Muslim, Bika. And he, through you, Umirtu, I've been commanded to open this door to nobody but you. But through you, by virtue of your rank with Allah Ta'ala, Allah Ta'ala gave me this position. Like, you know, somebody wants to become the sort of keeper of paradise, the Prophet ﷺ puts in a good word for Ridwan there. And Allah Ta'ala gives Ridwan the post at paradise, so that nobody enters paradise save through salam. So, from whom? From Ridwan himself. Salamun alaykum tibatum fadukhuluha khalidin. The words of Sayyidina whom Ridwan in Surah Az-Zumar.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah is the light of the heavens on the earth. The likeness of his light is that of a niche in which there is a lamp. The lamp inside a glass. The glass like a brilliant star, lit from a blessed tree, an olive. Neither of the east nor of the west, its oil, all but giving off light even if no fire touches it. Light upon light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides to his light anyone he wills. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes likeness for mankind, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has knowledge of everything.
And in light, in Surah An-Nur in the Quran, the verse of light. قال الله تعالى الله نور السماوات والأرض مثل نوره كمشكاة فيها مصباح المصباح في الزجاجة الزجاجة كأنها كوكب دري يوقد من شجرة مباركة زيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية يكاد زيتها يضيء ولو تمسسه النار نور على نور يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم. نور نور light.
كعب
الإمام كعب الأحبار رضي الله عنه ورضاه إمام التابعين formerly a rabbi Jewish the enters the fold of Islam رضي الله عنه ورضاه dies in the age of Sayyidina Uthman Sayyidina كعب الأحبار the most knowledgeable people of Ahl al-Islam. Likewise, Wa ibn Jubayr, that's the great Imam Sa'id ibn Jubayr, rahimahullah ta'ala. Some consider him the most knowledgeable man of the Tabi'een, Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Yani Maqtul al-Hajjaj, the one who was killed by Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Jubayr, rahimahullah ta'ala. Imam of the Tabi'een died in the year 97. These two, what is the opinion of Sayyidina Ka'b al-Ahbar and Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Jubayr, rahimahullah ta'ala? Al-Murad bin Nur al-Thani huna Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That the meaning of light, yani light inside of the verse of light is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the meaning. The great Imams and Tabi'een say, وَقَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى مَثُلُ نُورِهِ the likeness of his light, a نُورِ مُحَمَّدٍ sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It means the light of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, these are the Imams of the Tabi'een. Not like Tabi'een, but the Imams, Imma to Imma. and the leaders of the Tabi'in at the highest level of knowledge, and their interpretation of the most central verse about light inside of the Quran, the verses of light in the chapter of light, is that the light is referring to the Prophet ﷺ. And you, at that point, it's difficult for you to negotiate some other type of interpretation. Very difficult. This is the Salaf, and this is the Imams of the Salaf who are holding this opinion. Radiallahu anhum wa
ta'ala. Ka'am al-Akhbar and Ibn Jubayr said, by the second light he means Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the likeness of his light, meaning the light of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sahil ibn Abdullah at-Tustari said that it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the guide of the people of the heavens and the earth. Then Sahil said, like the light of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when it is lodged in the loins like a niche. By the lamp he means his heart. The glass is his breast. It is as if it were a brilliant star because of the belief and wisdom it contains, lit from a blessed tree, i.e. from the light of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He makes a comparison with the blessed tree and he says, its oil all but giving off light, i.e. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's prophethood is almost evident to the people before he speaks, just like this soil. A lot more is said about this ayah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what it means.
قال سهل بن عبد الله المعنى الله هادي أهل السماوات والأرض ثم قال مثل نور محمد إذ كان مستضعا في الأصلاب كمشكاة صفته كذا وأراد بالمصباح قلبه بالزجاجة صدره أي كأنه كوكب دري لما فيه من الإيمان والحكمة يوقد من شجرة مباركة أي من نور إبراهيم وضرب المثل بالشجرة المباركة وضرب المثل بالشجرة المباركة وقوله يكاد زيتها يضيء أي تكاد نبوة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم تبين للناس قبل كلامه كهذا زيت وقد قيل في هذا الآية غير هذا والله أعلم وقد سماه الله تعالى في القرآن في غير هذا الموضع نورا وسراجا منيرا وقال تعالى قد جاءكم من الله نور وكتاب مبين وقال تعالى إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا ومن هذا قوله تعالى ألم نشرح لك صدرك ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقض ظهرك ورفعنا لك ذكرك فإن مع العسر يسرا إن مع العسر يسرا فإذا فرغت فانصب وإلى ربك فارغب.
Elsewhere in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a light and a light-giving lamp. He says, a light and a clear book have come to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, he sent you as a witness, a bringer of good news, and a warner, one who calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his permission and a light-giving lamp. This is why he says, did we not expand your breast for you? To expand, shahraha, is to make wide, vast. By the word breast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here means the heart. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, he expanded it with the light of Islam. Sahal al-Tustari said, with the light of the message. Hassan al-Basri said, he filled it with judgment and knowledge. It is also said that it means, did we not purify your heart so that it was not allowed in any whispering from shaitan? The surah continues, and we lifted your burden from you, the burden that weighed down your back. It is said that this means his wrong actions, i.e. from time to time he was a prophet. It is said that it means the burden of the days of the Jahiliyyah. It is said that the meaning is the message which weighed down his back before he conveyed it. And this is the opinion of Al-Mawardi and As-Sulami. It is also said that it means we protected you, and if it had not been for that, wrong actions would have burdened your back. And that is what As-Samarqandi relates. The surah continues, did we not raise high your renown? Yahya ibn Adam said that this meant by being given prophethood. It is said that the meaning of these words is explained by the Hadith al-Qudsi. When I am mentioned, you are mentioned with me in the statement. There is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is also said that the same is done by means of the adhan. What is clear is that by these words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirms the immensity of the favour he has bestowed upon his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his noble station with him, and the honour in which he holds him. He expanded his breast to belief and guidance, and made it wide enough to contain knowledge and bear wisdom. He removed from him the burdens of all the things of the Jahiliyyah, and made their pursuance hateful to him. by giving him victory to his deen all over other deens. He lightened for him the weighty responsibility of the message and prophethood, so he could convey to people what was sent down to him. He re-emphasized the sublime position, majestic rank, highly known of his prophet, and joined his name to his own name. Qatada said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exalted his fame in this world and the next. There is no speaker, witness, nor anyone doing the prayer who fails to say, there is no God but Allah, but Allah, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah.
شرح وسع والمراد بصدري هنا الخلق قال ابن عباس شرحه بالإسلام وقال سهل بنور الرسالة وقال حسن ملاه حكما وعلما وقيل معنى ولم نذحر قلبك حتى لا يؤذيك الوسواس ووضعنا عنك وزرك الذي أنقذ ظهرك قيل ما سلف من ذنبك يعني قبل النبوة وقيل أراد ثقل أيام الجاهلية وقيل أراد ما أثقل ظهره من الرسالة حتى بلغها أتاهما وردي والسلمي وقيل عصمناك ولولا ذلك الأثقلك الذنوب ظهرك حكاه سمرقندي ورفعنا لك ذكرك قال يحيى بن آدم بالنبوة وقيل إذا ذكرت معي قول لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله وقيل في الآذان قال الفقيه القاضي أبو الفضل رحمه الله هذا تقرير من الله جل اسمه لنبيه صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم على عظيم نعمه اللذين وشريف منزلته عنده وكرامته عليه بأن شرح قلبه للإيمان والهداية وسعه لوعي العلم وحمل الحكمة ورفع عنه ثقل أمور الجاهلية عليه وبغضه لسيرها وما كان عليه بظهور دينه على الدين كله وحط عنه عهدة أعباء الرسالة والنبوة لتبليغه للناس ما نزل إليهم وتنويه بعظيم مكانه وجليل رتبته ورفعه ذكره وقرانه مع اسمه اسمه قال القتادة رفع الله فكره في الدنيا والآخرة فليس خطيب ولا متشهد ولا صاحب صلاة إلا يقول أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وروى أبو سعيد الخدري أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أتاني جبريل عليه السلام فقال إن ربي وربك يقول تدري كيف رفعت ذكرك قلت الله ورسوله أعلم قال إذا ذكرت معي قال ابن عطاء جعلت تمام الإيمان بذكري معك وقال أيضا جعلتك ذكرا من ذكري فمن ذكرك ذكرني وقال جعفر بن محمد الصادق لا يذكرك أحد بالرسالة إلا ذكرني بالربوبية وأشار بعضهم إلى ذلك إلى الشفاعة ومن ذكره معه تعالى أن قرن طاعته بطاعته واسمه باسمه فقال تعالى وأطيعوا الله والرسول وقال تعالى وآمنوا بالله ورسوله فجمع بينها بواو العطف المشركة ولا يجوز جمع هذا الكلام في غير حقه عليه السلام حدثنا الشيخ أبو علي الحسين بن محمد الجياني الحافظ فيما أجازنيه وقرأته على الثقة عنهم قال حدثنا أبو عمر النمري قال حدثنا أبو محمد بن عبد المؤمن حدثنا أبو بكر بن داسة حدثنا أبو داود السجزي حدثنا أبو الوليد الطيالسي حدثنا شعبة عن منصور عن عبد الله بن يسار عن حذيفة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يقول لأن أحدكم ما شاء الله وشاء فلان ولكن ما شاء الله ثم شاء فلان قال الخطابي أشرهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إلى الأدب في تقديم مشيئة الله تعالى على مشيئة من سواه واختارها ثم التي هي للنسق والتراخي بخلاف الواو التي هي الاشتراك ومثل الحديث الآخر إن خطيبا خطب عند النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعصهما قال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بئس خطيب القوم أنت قم أو قال اذهب قال أبو سليمان كريا منه الجمع بين الاسمين بحرف الكناية لما فيه من التسوية وذهب غيره إلى أنه إنما كره له الوقوف على يعصهما
Abu Sa'id al-Khudri related that the Prophet ﷺ said, Jibreel, peace be upon him, came to me and said, My Lord and your Lord says, Do you know how I have exalted your fame? I said, Allah and His Messenger know best. He said, When I am mentioned, you are mentioned with me.
And that's important. Always keep in mind the fact that whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned, that the Prophet ﷺ is also mentioned. And that's esteem for the Prophet ﷺ. سيدنا حسان بن ثابت وشق له من اسمه لِيُجِلَّهُ That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken from his name and apportioned it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahibu sallam, Sayyidina Hassan sallam. It's great that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always mentioned alongside Allah jalla fil ula.
Ibn Atta quoted a hadith Qudsi saying, I completed belief with your being mentioned with me. And another one which says, I have made your mention part of my mention. So whoever mentioned me, mentioned you. Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq said, no one mentions you as a messenger, but that he mentions me as the Lord. Some of the people of knowledge, such as al-Mawardi, suggested that the station of intercession was being referred to by this.
That's like in the tradition, Tabarani, the clarification of the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Baqarah, وَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّي كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ That Sayyidina Adam, he embraced words from his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ So he turned towards Allah in penance, and Allah turned towards him. I accepted his penance, his repentance. Kalimat. And it's two readings of the Quran. In one reading of the Quran, Adam embraces the words. The other reading of the Quran in Baqarah, same verse, that's the words that embrace Adam. But the most important thing is, what are the words? What are the words? Those words. That is in a mutual relationship with the great Prophet Adam alayhi salam, after he did whatever he did inside of paradise. In the hadith of Tabarani, that's in Adam alayhi salam, that he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive him bihaqi Muhammad. By virtue of the rank of Muhammad, hadith in Tabarani. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Sayyidina Adam, Aina arafta Muhammad? He said, where did you know Muhammad from? And Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam said, Nadartu ila qa'imat al-arsh. I gazed at the shank of the throne. And I saw, La ilaha illallah, Allah Muhammad, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I saw Allah Muhammad. And I knew that you would not mention any name alongside your name, say that name and the entity who it represents is great with you. The concomitance of the name of the Prophet ﷺ with what the name of Allah Jalla fil Ula. And Allah Ta'ala said, Na'am, Ya Adam. Yes, O Adam. Walawlahu, if it was not for him, ma khalaqatuka. I would not even have created you. If it was not for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
The fact that mention of the Prophet ﷺ is directly connected to mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also shows that obedience to the Prophet ﷺ is connected to obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his name to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, obey Allah and his messenger and believe in Allah and his messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala joins them together using the conjunction wa, which is the conjunction of partnership. It is not permitted to use this conjunction in conjunction with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the case of anyone except the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hudhayfa said that the Prophet ﷺ said, none of you should say what Allah wills and what so and so wills. Rather say what Allah wills, then stop and say so and so wills. Al-Khattabi said, the Prophet ﷺ has guided you to correct behavior in putting the will of Allah before the will of others. He chose then thumma, which implies sequence and deferred and deference as opposed to and wa, which implies partnership. Something similar is mentioned in another hadith. Someone was speaking in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and grant him peace, and said, whoever obeys Allah and his messenger has been rightly guided, and whoever rebels against them both, joining them together by using the dual form, the Prophet ﷺ said to him, what a bad speaker you are, get up, or he said, get out. Abu Sulaiman said, he disliked the two names being joined together in that way because it implies equality. Someone else thought that what he disliked was stopping that whoever rebels against them.
And so here, like in the tradition here, يَلِي بِئْسَ خَتِيبُ الْقَوْمِ أَنْتَ Hadith Abu Dawood, here the Prophet ﷺ, and in the خَتِيبَ الْخَطَبَ عِنْدَ النَّبِي, that there was somebody who gave a sermon in the presence of the Prophet ﷺ. فَقَالَ مَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ رَشَدْ That whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, that they have guided aright. وَمَنْ يَعْصِهِمَا Whoever disobeys both of them, and he stops. فَقَالَ مَهُ النَّبِي صَعَلِهِ It was in the Prophet that he said to him, بِئْسَ خَتِيبُ الْقَوْمَ أَنْتَ What a wretched sermonizer of a people you are. قُمْ Arise. The Prophet ﷺ said in another riwayah, says, Idhab, leave. The Prophet ﷺ said to him. Qala Abu Sulaiman, Abu Sa'id, what did the Prophet dislike? Why did he tell the man to leave? Kariha minhu al-jama' bayna al-ismaini بحرف الكناية لما فيه من التسوية. Yani the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam disliked, Abu Sulaiman said the Prophet disliked that the Khatib had used a pronoun which alludes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi being the same as God. That's the first position. Yani, you can use that pronoun. Because Allah Ta'ala, yani, وَمَنْ يُتِعَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ Allah and His Rasul. Now when you say both of them, does that sound? That's what the first position of Abu Sulaiman, the Prophet disliked that. That's a position. Others said no, that's not what the Prophet disliked, but he disliked rather al-waquf ala ya'asihima. Whoever, he disliked the fact that the Khatib stopped. And he just said, whoever disobeys them, and then he stopped. He didn't say whoever disobeys them, and he didn't clarify what happens on the basis of disobedience to Allah Ta'ala and His Messenger. Yet Allah Ta'ala alam. Also Allah Ta'ala says that Allah has meant a haqq and yurduh. Yet Allah Ta'ala in the Quran, He said Allah and His Messenger, they have more right that you please them. I'm talking about the issue of Abu Sulaiman. And what's the point here? That Allah Ta'ala in the Quran, that He joins between Himself and the Prophet with a pronoun. Ya'ni, if there's going to be bad adab with the Prophet, where's the bad adab? To give you a third opinion, is that the bad adab here is the fact that by saying, وَمَنْ يَعْسِهِمَا, by saying whoever disobeys them, Hima, you separated between Allah Ta'ala and the Prophet. It's not an issue of taswiyah, seeing them on the same degree. It's an issue of you separating between God and His Messenger. Do you understand that? Why? Because in the Quran Himself, Allah joins between the Prophet, not with the pronoun of the dual, but the pronoun of the singular. Which means Allah and His Messenger has. It's the same thing we're dealing with here. And so when you separate me from God, that is qillat al-adab with me. That's bad adab with me. The Prophet ﷺ is alluding to here, to the one. Qum, idhab, arise, leave. The presence of the Prophet ﷺ, wa'ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. وقول أبو سليمان صح لما روي في الحديث صحيح أنه قال ومن يعسيهما فقد غوى ولم يذكر الوقوف على يعسيهما وقد اختلف المفسرون وأصحاب المعاني في قوله تعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي وهل يصلون راجعة على الله تعالى والملائكة أم لا فأجازوا بعضهم ومنعه آخرون لعلة التشريك وخصوا الضمير بالملائكة وقدروا الآية إن الله يصلي وملائكته يصلون وقد روى عن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال من فضيلتك عند الله تعالى أن جعل طاعتك طاعته فقال تعالى من يطع الرسول فقد طاع الله وقد قال تعالى قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله واغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم قل أطيعوا الله والرسول فإن تولوا فإن الله لا يحب الكافرين وروي أنه لما نزلت هذه الآية قالوا إن محمدا يريد أن يتخذه حنانا كما اتخذت النصارى عيسى فأنزل الله تعالى قل أطيعوا الله والرسول فقرن طاعته بطاعته رغما لهم وقد اختلف المفسرون في معنى قوله تعالى في الأم الكتاب اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم فقال أبو العالية والحسن البصري الصراط المستقيم هو رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وخيار أهل بيته وأصحابه حكاه عنهما أبو الحسن الماوردي وحكى مكي عنهما نحوه وقال هو رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صاحباه أبو بكر وعمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما وحكى أبو الليث السمرقندي مثله عن أبي عالية في قوله تعالى صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم قال فبلغ ذلك الحسن فقال صدق والله ونصح وحكى الموارد ذلك في التفسير صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم عن عبد الرحمن بن زيد وحكى أبو عبد الرحمن السلمي عن بعضهم في التفسير قوله تعالى فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى لا انفصام لها والله سميع عليم عنه محمد عليه السلام وقيل الإسلام وقيل شهادة التوحيد وقال سحر في قوله تعالى وإن تعدوا نعمة الله لا تحصوها قال نعمته بمحمد عليه السلام وقال تعالى والذي جاء بالصدق وصدق به أولئك هم المتقون لهم ما يشاءون عند ربهم ذلك جزاء المحسنين أكثر المفسرين على أن الذي جاء بالصدق هو محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم قال بعدهم هو الذي صدق به وقل يا صدق بالتخفيف وقال غيرهم الذي صدق به المؤمنين وقيل أبو بكر وقيل علي وقيل غير ذلك من الأقوال وعن مجاهد في قوله تعالى ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب قال بمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم أصحابه
Abu Sulaiman's statement is sounder since it is related in another sound recension of the hadith that he said, whoever rebels against them has erred without stopping after whoever rebels against them. The commentators and etymologists disagree regarding the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah and his angels pray blessings on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about whether the word pray, masculine plural, refers to both Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels or not. Some of them allow it to refer to both, while others forbid this because of the idea of partnership. They make the pronoun refer to the angels alone and understand the ayah as Allah prays and his angels pray. It is related that Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah ta'ala be pleased with him, said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, part of your excellence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he has made obedience to you, obedience to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever obeys the messenger has obeyed Allah. And if you love Allah, then follow me, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. It is related that when this ayah was sent down, people said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants us to make him as a mercy in the way the Christians did with Isa alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, say, obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the messenger. Allah connected obedience to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with obedience to himself, in spite of what people said. The commentators disagree about the meaning of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Fatiha. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those who you have blessed. Abu al-Aliyah and al-Hasan al-Basri radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, the straight path is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah bless him and grant him peace. The best of the people of his house and his companions. Al-Hasan al-Mawardi related that Abu al-Aliyah and al-Hasan al-Basri, the straight path is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the best of the people of his house and his companions. Makki related something similar. This refers to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may Allah ta'ala bless him and grant him peace, and his two companions, Abu Bakr and Umar, may Allah ta'ala be pleased with them both. Abu al-Layth as-Samarqandi related almost the same from Abu al-Aliyah regarding the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the path of those whom you have blessed. Al-Hasan al-Basri heard it and said, it is true by Allah and this is good counsel. Al-Muwardi relates that in this commentary on the words, the path of those whom you have blessed, from Abdul Rahman ibn Zayd. Abdul Rahman as-Sulami related that one of the commentators said that in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has taken hold of the firmest handle. The firmest handle is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is also said that it means Islam. It is said that it means a testimony of Tawheed, that there is no God but Allah. Sahal al-Bustari said that the words of Allah, if you were to count the blessings of Allah, you will not be able to number them, refer particularly to the blessings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he who brings the truth and he who confirms it, such are God-fearing. Most of the commentators say that the one who brought the truth is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them said, he is the one who confirmed it. Sometimes this word is read as sadaqa, spoken the truth, and sometimes sadaqa, confirmed it, i.e. referring to the believers. It is said that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu is meant that it is said that it refers to Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and other things are said as well. Mujahid said that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hearts are stilled by the remembrance of Allah, refer to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions.
InshaAllah. Allahu a'lam. InshaAllah ta'ala, the month of Rabi is entered, inshaAllah tabarakAllah. One of the things we made mention about one of the ways that we increase our love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to try to make our hearts sort of moist in the remembrance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through words known as salawat. As you have Qadi Iyad rahimahullah ta'ala referred to, Allah bi dhikrillah tatamin al-qulub. Is enough with the remembrance of Allah ta'ala, tatamin al-qulub. The heart move into a state of serenity, of tranquility. And he said, the dhikrillah here is dhikri Muhammad. is through the mentioning of the Prophet ﷺ, especially in this sense, through salawat. And so we should try our best during this month, inshallah, tabarakallah, the first night of the blessed month, the month of prophecy. And it says, you try our best to be of those who are moist, or render our tongues moist in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And whenever you make salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're also mentioning God. It's dhikr Allah. Allahumma. It begins with Allah. Allah. That's how it begins. So in the mentioning of the Rasul is also the mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we just read through it briefly. Our teacher Habib Umar in Hafidh every year, and he gives salawat that we should try to perform during the great month. And this year he's given a salawat 3,000 times for us to attempt to do, inshallah, tabarakah. And all we have to do here, the simplest way, is that we pray that the month is as long as it can be, i.e. it's a 30-day month or a 29-day month. So we're able to do this salawat, 10 times before every prayer and 10 times after every prayer. Just 10 times, you would do 3,000 times during the entire month. And it's the easiest way to see your 3,000 now. So before you pray Fajr, then you do 10 times this salawat. After you pray Fajr, then do 10 times you do this salawat. Before you pray Dhuhr, 10 times. After Dhuhr, 10. وَحَلُّمَّ جَرَّ And so on until the end of the month, inshallah ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ يُوَفِّقْكُمْ فِي ذَلِكَ And the salawat he gave, Allahumma ya ni'mal mawla wa ya ni'mal nasir. Salli wa sallam adada ilmika ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Man ja'altahu lana hirzan hariza. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi. Wa ansurna bihi wal muslimina bi asrari. Wa yansuruka Allahu nasran aziza. Allahumma ya ni'mal mawla wa ni'mal nasir. Salli wa sallim. عدد علمك على سيدنا محمد من جعلته لنا هرزا حريزا وعلى آله وصحبه وانصرنا به والمسلمين بأسرار وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا يعني it's been typed up inshallah ta'ala and Khalid will ensure that it reaches everyone inshallah ta'ala and it translates oh God oh how blessed the patron is he Allah Oh, how blessed the victor is he, Allah. Send blessings and peace upon our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the extent of your knowledge, the one who you rendered a fortified fortress for us and upon his house and companions. And by virtue of him, grant us and the Muslims victory through the secrets of, and God will surely grant you a mighty victory. The Surah Al-Fatiha. So we try to say that, salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, 3,000 times. Inshallah, after each dars, we will just do the salat of tajiyah, inshallah, tabarakallah, inshallah ta'ala, to ensure that this ta'atir of the majlis, although this ta'atir through the study of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, likewise the dhikr from the great adhkar of the imams and the salawat of the imams is also, inshallah ta'ala, warranted. So it's in the khulasa, for those who have the khulasa, we read from page 182 in this version of the khulasa. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما لبيك اللهم لبيك اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم وترحم على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما ترحمت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم تحنن على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما تحننت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم وسلم على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما سلمت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد في كل لحظة أبدى عدل خلقك ورضا نفسك وزنة عرشك ومداد كلماتك اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وكرم بقدر عظمة ذاتك العليا في كل وقت وحين أبدا عدل ما علمت وزنة ما علمت وملا ما علم صلى الله عليه على سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه صاحب التاج والمعراج والبراق والعلم صلى الله عليه ودافع البلاء والوباء والمرض والألم صلى الله عليه جسمه مطهر معطر منور صلى الله عليه من اسمه مكتوب مرفوع موضوع على اللوح والقلم صلى الله عليه شمس الضحى بدر الدجى نور الهدى مصباح الظلم صلى الله عليه أبي القاسم سيد الكونين وشفيع الثقلين صلى الله عليه أبي القاسم سيدنا محمد عبد الله سيد العرب والعجم صلى الله عليه نبي الحرمين محبوب عند رب المشرقين والمغربين صلى الله عليه يا أيها المشتاقون لنور جماله صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم يا نعم المولى ونعم النصير صل وسلم عدل علمك على سيدنا محمد من جعلته لنا حرزا حريزا وعلى آله وصحبه وانصر نبي والمسلمين بأثاره وينصرك الله ناصرا عزيزا اللهم يا نعم المولى ونعم النصير صل وسلم عدل علمك على سيدنا محمد من جعلته لنا حرزا حريزا وعلى آله وصحبه وانصر نبي والمسلمين بأثاره وينصرك الله ناصرا عزيزا اللهم يا نعم المولى ونعم النصير صلي وسلم على علمك يعني عدل علمك على سيدنا محمد ما جعلته لنا حرزا حريزا وعلى آله وصحبه وانصرنا به ومسلمين بيساره وينصرك الله نصرا عزيزا وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم سر الفاتحة إلى حضرة النبي اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه الفاتحة